afternoon, everyone, and let me welcome you to this briefing this afternoon, which I think is going to be really exciting and hopefully very informative to those of you that represent congressional offices that might be interested in the policies of education reform, the nonprofits many of you represented that are actually engaged, not only here in Washington, D.C., but in places like Louisiana and Tennessee and maybe other places around the country. I am very pleased to help host this. Lamar Alexander and I serve, Senator Lamar Alexander and I serve as co-chairs of the Public Charter Caucus in the United States Congress. Senator Alexander has been a longtime supporter of charter schools as governor of Tennessee, as secretary of education prior to his service as senator from Tennessee. And I've been a longtime supporter of public charter schools ever since I heard about them, you know, over 15 years ago, and have been very intrigued by the opportunity for traditional public schools to become more independent and for principals and teachers to become more empowered. And instead of being controlled by the system, they can start controlling the system. And of course, with that, being held accountable for the outcomes. And the most exciting thing, of course, is to see high quality charter schools and the impact that they have on the academic achievement of children is really extraordinary. The other wonderful thing about public charter schools is it opens up our public school system to a diverse set of providers that have so much talent and resources to bring to our public school system that is really very, in my view right now, very centralized, very closed, and in most places failing miserably and shamefully in the greatest nation in the world. Not only is this an economic imperative to better train the workforce of the future, I do a lot of this work because I think it's a national security issue for any nation that wants to continue to be a great economic powerhouse. If we're not able to graduate 90 to 100% of our high schoolers, and when they receive that diploma, have that diploma be meaningful in the sense that they can walk out of the school and find a job right away that pays a decent wage, or get into a college of their choice or a two-year college of their choice without having to take remedial work, that's where we need to be. We're not anywhere near that standard in America today. As a former state legislator, former state treasurer that helped to put an investment portfolio together for our schools to give them extra support, as a legislator on the front lines at the state level where 70% of the money for public education comes from, I've been engaged in these battles for a long time and have come to the conclusion that one of the extraordinarily opportunities is to transform mediocre, poor, centralized school systems by infusing high-quality charter operators. If they can be locally grown and developed, fabulous. If not, they can come out of the districts to serve as models. We're going to hear from some of the most, I think, exciting on-the-ground operators of and associations that are promoting charter schools. New Orleans has become the first real city in America to move from a traditional public school, centralized, failing, mediocre system to a vibrant 80% of our kids today are in public charter schools. It happened very quickly over 5 years. There's some upsides and downsides to that kind of quick transformation, but in 3 years, 90% of all the children in Orleans Parish will be in a public charter school. The results speak for themselves, and I'm very pleased to have on this, to welcome you all today. And then to just, I'm not introducing the panel, but I'm gonna turn it over to the moderator who will introduce those that are on the panel today. And I'm gonna stay here through the hour. I'm very interested in hearing the presentation. Of course, I've heard bits and pieces of it before. So excited to have the Undersecretary with us. But whoever is the moderator, right here, honey, okay? If you will take over from here, and thank you all so much, and welcome to the Senate.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Senator, both for your long-term leadership on public education issues and as well for hosting this briefing today. The first, it is in that department that the Investing in Innovation Fund sits, and which New Schools for New Orleans is a grantee. So I'll turn things over to Jim to give us a little bit of context on this program.
Sure. First, hey John, how's it going?
John, how are you?
First, yes, thanks to you, Senator Landrieu, and his absence, Senator Alexander. We're here today to talk about, obviously, the work that New Schools of New Orleans has done and then more patently focused on charters. But in fact, the reason that they received a particular grant that I'm focused on today is because they were an early I-3. I-3 is the short name for the Investment Innovation Fund. It was originally called the What Works in Innovation Fund, and I'm sure John will talk about that a little bit when he makes his remarks. I think it's really important for us. Can you hear me?
Speak more into the mic with
him. Okay, good deal. I think it's important for us, as anytime you start talking about innovation, to be really clear about what definition of innovation we're talking about. Because people say innovation, 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 and mean different things. So there are two things that we're trying to focus on. One is that innovation means it's the thing that is being done now is significantly better than the status quo. This new thing, this approach, this strategy, this new way of doing work is significantly better than the status quo, producing outcomes that are different. But the second part of the definition is equally important, because we have these isolated examples of excellence throughout the education system that somehow failed to scale. And so the question isn't whether or not you've got something, just whether you've got something that's significantly better than the status quo. Have you got something significantly better than the status quo that goes to scale? If you just have something that's really great, that does a lot better, but doesn't touch enough people to make a real difference, then it's a great invention. It is that combination of really having something that can make a difference and then scaling to a point where it makes a big difference for a lot of people, that means it's an innovation. Now, why is that important? Because in education, we have actually not had a system that causes that to happen. The ecosystem in which education, innovation, and education lives is fractured in a number of different places. And this program was put together in a way that in almost any other sector would seem pretty nonsensical. Like, hey, sure, it makes sense that you ought to give a little bit of money for a little bit of evidence and a lot of money for a lot of evidence. Take those things that have a really strong evidence and help them to go to scale, and make sure you're feeding the pipeline of new ideas that have real promise and vetting them in a way that lets you know whether they deserve to go further. Like, that is a cycle that many sectors are familiar with that hasn't been disciplined in the education sector. The Investment Innovation Fund, I-3, is designed to do just that. We've been very fortunate. It's gone had two rounds now. 72 total grantees, 49 in the first year, 23 in the second year. And I want to put this work in context because we talked about being evidence-based in education for some time. But the reality is that though we built some of the infrastructure and the resources through IES, and there was a significant amount of work on this, the What Works Clearinghouse, which houses those things that have met that rigorous standard, oftentimes does not contain the resources that educators are looking for when they're trying to solve problems. And in fact, NDRC did a study with Bloom leading it to find out how many studies were there in the education space that met the high quality design specifications for that the IES uses. And they came up with a number that was about 60 based on what they found. If we work according to plan, the first cohort of I-3 will produce 26 more. Right? So don't think about I-3 in the context of a single year. Think about it year after year after year. In 5 to 7 years, we have a portfolio of hundreds of things that actually educators return to that have rigorous evidence that either they work or they don't, which is equally important. Now, we are here today to talk about one specific grantee, New Schools of New Orleans. They're an important example of what I-3 can do because they actually are doing several things that are emblematic of the program. One is they're tackling a challenge that is a persistent challenge throughout the country. And that is, how do you consistently start and run high quality public schools? These schools happen to be charters, but we know that because of the work that we're doing through the School Improvement Grant Program and numerous other programs throughout the country, that question is not one that's just about charters, it's about any kind of public school that we happen to be trying to open, whether it be a magnet school or a traditional public school that is replacing a failing school today. We also know that, in fact, it is difficult to do that in environments and communities where the infrastructure does not exist to support them. Just like in business, where most small businesses fail, most new schools actually don't do well when they start. And it takes time for them to get traction, and so you see a distribution of performance. And the question is, how can you get that distribution of performance and keep moving further and further so you get a higher and higher probability that every school that starts turns out to be high performing? That is the question at hand. The second thing is that it does leverage, as the program requires, strong public and private partnerships, bringing in resources from the outside to complement the public resources, bringing expertise and bringing in entrepreneurs and innovators from the community and from outside the community to try and do this work. Also something that we think is an important part of driving innovation in the field. And then third, it's designed with the evaluation embedded to make sure that as we're doing this work, we are actually vetting it, determining whether it's working as planned, codifying what's happening in the best cases, and recognizing where there are gaps in the work. It's still too early to tell whether New Schools of Orleans or any of the others in the portfolio are true successes. What is good is that there are good leading indicators. What is also true is that there have been gaps along the way, things that they recognize that they've missed, organizations and schools that have started that have not hit their stride the way that they'd like. And when you look at the entire portfolio, you say, this is much, much better than what was there before, but very far from the benchmark that the Senator just laid out about what we want for every single one of our children. The question for us is, does that mean we should stop? Or does that mean this is part of the learning process for us to get the kind of outcomes that we want? That in fact, you take the step forward, you learn from it, you build on it, and you then have another innovation or build on this one so that you can get to your ultimate goal. That is the design of the program. Year after year, keep getting better. Year after year, to address these persistent challenges. Year after year, to take the lessons that we learn, capture them, codify them, disseminate them so others can learn from them, and have it continue to get better outcomes for our children. With that, I'd like to close my opening remarks. I do want to say a couple of important things as I close. One, the early indicators are promising in Orleans. They're not perfect, but the most important thing to know is that student outcomes in the vast majority of schools started through this program are doing significantly better than in comparison groups. The second, one of the unwritten questions about this is a place-based strategy. It means this is not about stringing up schools across communities within New Orleans and then, or one chain running across the country. It is when they're working in New Orleans, whether they're working in Tennessee, how do they complement and leverage the resources and assets of that community? How do they make connection with communities so that these schools become vibrant and sustainable over time, but ultimately still get the outcome goals that we're looking for? That part of learning about how these schools become part of the community, the community feels ownership of them, is as important learning for the success and sustainability of the program as it is the actual outcomes of the students. At least that's our hypothesis anyway. Thank you.
We're honored to have today with us Nirav Kingsley. Nirav is the Chief Strategy Officer at New Schools for New Orleans. He's been with the organization since its founding in 2006, right after the storm, which was in August of 2005. And he's also the author of one of the authors of the report that's come out today that you all should have in your briefing packet, The New Orleans Style Education Reform, A Guide for Cities. Nirav, great.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Senator Landrieu. Thank you, Senator Alexander. It's really humbling to be here in our nation's capital and get to tell the New Orleans story, work that's been driven by thousands of phenomenal educators in New Orleans and many people in this room. I see friends from the Walton Foundation, the Gates Foundation, KIPP, Teach for America. You all have been incredible supports to the work we've done in New Orleans, and thank you so much. Before I talk about the actual model that we've built and the foundation we've built, hopefully for future success, I want to spend a couple of minutes talking about where we came from. And I want to share a quick story about a woman named Bridget Green. Bridget Green was the valedictorian of Forshay High School. Those of you who are familiar with New Orleans, it's a school in Uptown. And at the time, it wasn't even one of the lowest performing schools. Bridget and her 10th grade year took the graduate exit exam. At the time, you had to take this test to graduate from high school, covered roughly up through 9th grade math, and she failed it. Over the next couple of years, she failed it four more times. In her senior year, she went to her guidance counselor. She still ranked number one in her class, and I asked if she could drop gym and take a remedial math course. And her guidance counselor said no. Bridget failed the 10th grade high school exam again. She then took the ACT and she scored an 11. This put her in the bottom 1% of test takers in the country. This was a valedictorian of a New Orleans high school who ended up not being able to walk with her classmates during graduation because she couldn't pass the 10th grade exam. So this is really where we were, and there were 1,000 other Bridget Greens across the city. Students who were being under-delivered, adults were making promises that they weren't keeping. This was the state of the New Orleans education system. Then Hurricane Katrina hits. This is the nation's worst national disaster ever. 2,000 New Orleanians died. Our most vulnerable children are spread across the country. They're dislocated from their families. Undoubtedly, Hurricane Katrina gave us the opportunity to rebuild our system, but it also inflicted an incredible toll on our city. And the fact that we've achieved what we've achieved despite going through the country's greatest natural disaster, in my mind, is really a testament to human resilience and what's possible when you give children real opportunities. I want to talk for a second about how we thought about this when we were trying to rebuild the New Orleans system. There's a graphic up here. The key takeaway from the graphic is when we started looking at other cities, we clearly realized, and you all know this, New Orleans isn't alone. There's no urban center in this country that is performing at the levels we would want to perform and to send our own kids to. And the takeaway for us was, if you look within any system, if you go to the teachers, if you go to the unions, if you go to charter schools, if you think about curriculum, if you fix one of those things or two of those things, you're not going to change the game. If you do not tackle the very system itself, in 20 years, we're going to be back here at a congressional briefing telling stories like the one about Bridget Green, because nothing's ever really going to change. We've been trying to change within the system for decades now, and we haven't seen the results we wanted. So the story of New Orleans is fundamentally changing the way urban schools are run and the governance system of how they're run. As Senator Landrieu mentioned, now 80% of students attend charter schools. We are going to be the nation's first charter school district. Jim talked a little bit about the early results are promising. You can see a chart up here. In 2005, there was a 23-point proficiency gap between New Orleans and the state. 35% of New Orleans students were proficient. 58% of Louisiana students were proficient. In a six-year period, and that's only 5 education years in New Orleans because we lost a year due to Katrina, the rest of the state did not, we've over halved that. Now in New Orleans, 56% of students are proficient. We think within the next 5 years, if we can maintain this pace of growth, New Orleans will be the first urban center in the country to surpass its state average. We haven't seen any other city that's been able to do this. That being said, Louisiana is currently 49th in the country in student achievement when you look at NAEP scores. So catching our state average and surpassing it is an incredible milestone, but it's by no means where we want to end when we think of long-term college and career success. But New Orleans will most likely be the first urban center to surpass its state average in the next 5 years. More importantly, in terms of I-3 and the reform method we've taken, the big bet we made was a bet on charter schools, and it's working. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar. In 2009, Credo, which is a research group out of Stanford, did a 16-state study on charter schools across the country. And what they found was really sobering. Only 17% of charter schools in these 16 states were outperforming traditional schools. And even worse, 37% were underperforming the traditional system. Now, some folks and some charter folks kind of decried the methodology and it wasn't perfect, but I think the direction was basically right. The charter community had made a promise to the country that if you give us autonomy, we'll give you results, and that had not totally been delivered across these 16 states. When we got our I-3 award, we actually had to select an evaluator that would be judging our work and judging the charter schools in New Orleans. So what we did is we picked up the phone and we called Credo. And we said, we want you to do the exact same study you did in that 16-stage study, and we want you to do it on New Orleans. We want you to do it on an annual basis so we can track our progress. This is the latest results we have of the same study done on New Orleans charter schools. 48% of New Orleans charter schools are currently outperforming the traditional system. You have another roughly a quarter that are performing the same, another quarter that are underperforming. So we're outperforming the original 16-state study by a factor of 3 in terms of charter schools that are outperforming the traditional system. More importantly, and to Senator Lander's point, the system we've built itself is hinges upon the idea that we're going to grow great schools and close failing schools. So when they do this study again at the end of I-3, that red bar should be gone. There should be no charter schools in New Orleans that are underperforming the traditional system, because they should be closed if that's the performance they're delivering for kids. So that's the history and the results we've achieved to date. To put these results in perspective, when we talk about this in layman's terms, we talk about going from F to C. New Orleans was perhaps one of the worst school districts in the country, and we've really stabilized it. We have by no means achieved excellence yet. That's really the next 5 to 10 years of work. The principles and the system we've set up, though, we are confident can help get us there. And I want to talk a little bit about the system itself. It's very complicated, and it can be hard to wrap your head around what a decentralized system looks like. We've tried to boil it down in this guide to 5 key principles, which we think are scalable and that other cities can adopt. We're working with Tennessee right now, and in Memphis and Nashville to try to embrace some of these principles. Principle number 1 is perhaps the most radical principle of our system in terms of differentiating ourselves from other cities, and that is the role of government. In New Orleans, government increasingly does not hire teachers. It does not set curriculum. It does not determine the length of the school day. Government is slowly but surely transitioning from the role of directly operating schools to becoming a regulator. The way we have the SEC or the FCC or the EPA, the long-term role of government in New Orleans is to set the rules of the system, make sure the nonprofit actors that are operating schools follow those rules and deliver consequences to schools that are not. We feel this is really the right role of government, and it's an extremely, extremely important role. When we looked at other charter sectors and we saw urban centers that had varying charter quality, this was one of the greatest factors in our mind. How well was government acting as a regulator in this decentralized system? Principle number 2 is what and how we treat our great educators. In New Orleans, great educators are giving buildings, resources, political support to grow and serve more kids. There's no 40-year career track where you have to slowly bump up your way. If you are incredibly talented, we will do everything we can to get you a school, and if that school succeeds, for you to grow a network of multiple schools. So we're vastly accelerating how much impact our best educators can have in getting more kids in front of their schools and their teachers as quickly as possible. The flip side of this coin is failing schools. This system is predicated upon the idea that we will swiftly close underperforming schools. To date in New Orleans, every charter school that has not hit its academic marks within 4 years has been closed or transitioned under new management. So far, we have yet to waver on this principle. And this is perhaps the greatest risk of our system. If we do not have the courage to keep on transitioning failing schools, the system we put in place is going to slowly start to falter and dismantle. So we've been very aggressive about transitioning failing schools, and we have to continue to do this and have the political courage to do this, and it's only going to get harder and harder. Principle 4 is the idea that families have choice. For us, this is really a moral commitment. For me personally, I find it very morally troubling that in our country, we give parents the choice of where to go to the grocery store, which drugstore to go to, but perhaps the most important decision they're going to make in their child's life, in most cities across the country, we deprive parents of the power to make that choice, and we assign them to a school, which in my mind is just incredible hubris on our part, that we would say to any given family, your child should be educated in this environment and take that power away from them. In New Orleans, every parent can determine what school is best for their child and send them to that school. The last principle of the New Orleans system is educators have choice. To be honest, in hindsight, I don't think we knew how powerful this would be. There's no more monolithic bureaucracy that you're employed by if you're working in the New Orleans system. There's 30 to 40 different nonprofits. You can find a school that fits with you, a mission that fits with you, a leader that you admire, an academic philosophy that you believe in. And we think in the long term, this is going to do a credible amount to professionalize the teaching force. The teachers now have the power to find an organization that fits their values and their needs. The flip side of this is there is an incredible demand for excellent teachers in New Orleans. If you are a good teacher in New Orleans, you are highly valued. Everybody's recruiting you. They're going after you, which again, we think can do a lot to transform the profession. We're really valuing teachers for what they're bringing to our city and to our children. And if you are a great teacher in New Orleans, again, you get a ton of love, and every organization will be out to get you into their school, which is really having a transformational impact on the New Orleans system. So these are the key five principles. Again, it's a complicated system, but this is the foundation. The role of government is moving from the direct operator of schools to the regulator of schools. Great schools expand. Failing schools close, families have choice, educators have choice. I want to talk very briefly about the role of I3, and for those of you all who work in the federal government, if you ever wake up and wonder, you know, am I having an impact? Is this worth it, the crazy hours I'm putting in? I want to very directly tell you that the federal money that is being put into New Orleans right now is having a transformational effect on the lives of New Orleans children. I3 is accelerating what we're doing in an incredible way. I want to briefly hit on a quote that actually helped inspire our I3 grant. Secretary Duncan, he's made this a huge priority for the department, this idea of turning around the bottom 5% of schools in the country. This really stuck with us. And it, you know, it's always been unclear to me whether he meant in 4 years. We'll find out in time whether this is an 8-year, 10-year. But this has always been a key message of his. We need to tackle the bottom 5%. And we started thinking about what would that mean in New Orleans? And we looked at what we've been able to achieve to date in terms of closing failing schools. If you use the 2011 accountability mechanisms in Louisiana, in 2005, 78% of New Orleans schools were failing. 4 out of every 5 schools in New Orleans were dropout factories, kids were being underserved, they were not getting what they needed. Within 5 years, 6 years into 2010, we'd cut that to 40%. We'd halve the number of failing schools. Because of I3 and the federal investment, plus other work that's happening through the great educators in the city, we think within 5 years we can get this down to 5%. That will be in a 10-year period in one city, going from 80% of our schools failing to 5%. It's transformational change for a city. So when we thought about this 5%, we thought we could go much quicker, and we thought we could push the nation. So rather 5% over a 4 to 5 year period, we said we think we can do 5% annually. The math there is pretty simple. If you can turn around the bottom 5% of your schools on an annual basis, in a 5-year period, you will have turned around the bottom quarter of schools in your city. When we think about what I3 is, and what Jim was talking about scale, A, we haven't figured this out yet. This is our goal, to turn around the bottom quarter. If we're successful, and then working with the department and the folks in Tennessee and other leading cities, we can figure out how to scale this model. Imagine a world where our country can turn around the bottom 25% of schools in our nation in a 5-year period. When the senator talks about national security, moral imperatives, economic opportunity, if we as a country could harness our entrepreneurial talent to turn around the bottom quarter of schools in a 5-year period, we could change the trajectory of our nation. We're starting to build that model in New Orleans through the I3 grant. While I have your attention here, I can't resist but throwing a couple slides on what us in New Orleans think about when we think about the federal government's role in education. I am by no means a federal policy expert. You have some of those on the panel. But I want to talk about a couple ideas that really resonate with us. And for those of you who work deeply in education, you will have no doubt read multiple articles about other countries' educational systems, whether it's Finland, Singapore, China, Canada. Well, I want to introduce another international comparison in a slightly different angle. My mother's from India, so I nerdily follow Indian politics. You'll see a picture here of Manmohan Singh, who's the current Prime Minister of India. In 1991, he became the finance minister, and since then has moved on up. If you think our national education system is complicated, I encourage you to take a visit to India, which has a billion people, over 2,000 languages. It's just an incredibly, incredibly complicated country. After its independence, for most of the first 3 to 4 decades of independence, most of its economy was roughly government-run. The agriculture sector, the banking sector, and so forth were under the government purview. In 1991, when Manmohan Singh became the finance minister, he very thoughtfully and slowly started handing power back. And the term I like to use for this is relinquishment. He slowly and surely relinquished power from a centralized agency to Indian entrepreneurs and said, I'm not going to try to figure out what's best. I'm going to empower the thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of Indian entrepreneurs to revolutionize our economy and trust that they're going to get it done. In the 15 years that these models have been put in place, that Manmohan Singh's economic policies have been put in place, India's per capita income has nearly doubled. If you see the chart there, you can see what the skyrocketing per capita income looks like. If India can double its per capita income in a 15 years through the policies of relinquishment and returning power back to entrepreneurs, there's no reason our country can't do the same in education. I leave it to the experts of what the federal role is in empowering our educational entrepreneurs, but if we've learned anything about the New Orleans experience, it's returning power back to educators, back to parents, can lead to incredible results. And I think increasingly that this need not be just a New Orleans story or a Hurricane Katrina story. Some of you might be familiar with the work the Gates Foundation is doing right now and what they're calling district charter collaboratives, which is really getting district leadership and charter leadership to agree that great schools are great schools. We need to treat them equally and expand the ones that are working. There are now 16 cities across the country that have signed these compacts, serving over 2.8 million students, 5% of the students in the country. I think we might be upon a national moment where people are willing to take this idea seriously of empowering great educators and giving them the freedom to achieve greater results. I don't know quite what the federal government's role here is, but I think it's something everybody in this room should think very deeply about. And I think there's an emerging national opportunity to make this leap for our country. I want to end on two notes. Very quickly, our organization, New Schools for New Orleans, 99% of what we do and what we think about is New Orleans. We're happy to be here to talk in the capital about what we've done, but it's blood, sweat, and tears to try to serve the kids who haven't been served well over the past couple decades in the city that we love. But there's also a national component to this. And the national component, I think you can think about it in two ways. One is from a student perspective. Right now, there are too many children across this country, they tend to be minority, they tend to be poor, who think that they literally can't achieve. And the reason they think that is because they've been told in very direct and indirect lives, their whole lives, that they can't achieve. They've been sent to schools that are mediocre, they've been sent to facilities that are falling apart. And there's no place in the country, if you think of a high school kid, that they could look to and say, actually, this could be different. When we do this work in New Orleans, we are desperately trying to be that city. So that one day, imagine in Philadelphia and Chicago, a high school student could stand up who's attending a failing school and say, actually, it doesn't have to be like this. There is one city in this country that has proved that every kid can achieve. We're hoping to make that city New Orleans. The second component of it is on the adult side. There are thousands of millions of adults in this country who do not believe that poor minority children can learn. and they talk in code, and they say things like these kids or those kids, and right now there is no city to prove them wrong. There needs to be one city in this country when the next time an adult is standing up in a public meeting and whispers the words to those kids, that another adult can stand up and say, actually, you're wrong. There's one city in this country that has proven that every kid can learn. We are fighting day in and day out to make New Orleans the first city so adults and kids across the country can have one example to prove that it's possible. We think the other cities that we showed before have a chance. The work that's happening in Tennessee is very hopeful. But when you think of our country's recent education reform, we've proved what a great teacher can do. We've proved what a great school can do. We have yet to prove that a whole city can deliver an excellent education, and that really is the fight we're undertaking in New Orleans. Thank you.
Thank you, Nirav, in particular, for what has been an incredible journey, I'm sure, over the last few years, for your vision, for your hard work, and for your thoughtful reflectiveness here today. I want to introduce our last panel member, John Schnur, who is the Executive Chairman of America Achieves. Welcome, John. Good to have you here.
Thank you very much. Sorry, I was delayed from Boston, but I'm glad to be here.
No problem. Glad to have you. And we'll sort of transition at this point into a bit more of a panel discussion, but I wonder, John, if you can kick us off. The reason I think most of us are here in this room is because we care about having good schools for our kids. I think most of us are relatively neutral about what those schools actually look like and who runs them, but at the end of the day, we're here because we care about getting improved outcomes for our neediest children. Increasingly, we've seen nonprofits like New Schools for New Orleans play a bigger role in that landscape and in making that happen. We'd love to hear your reflections on what you think that role could be, should be, and any lessons learned so far.
It's great to be here, and it's such an incredibly important topic, both New Orleans and the reforms that have been undertaken in New Orleans over the last several years, that three program, the role of New Schools for New Orleans. You know, the people on the panel are extraordinary. Senator Landrieu has been providing leadership nationally in Louisiana for such a long time. Nirav has understated that the role that New Schools New Orleans plays has been fundamental in supporting reforms there, and Jim Shelton has been just leading, I think in a model for federal policy broadly, not just in education, but how to restructure federal programs. You have an amazing set of leaders here. Let me just make a few quick points. One is just on New Orleans and the context in which before New Schools New Orleans stepped in. You know, some people know, I went to my personal connection, my wife's from New Orleans, and so right after Katrina, I went down to try to help right after, about a week after, and while there was still water on the ground, I didn't know, what use I would be or our educational organization would be, but it turned out, while even there was water on the ground, there were education officials, elected leaders in Louisiana who were also beginning, after the immediate crisis was just beginning to pass a couple weeks after, to look at the water tournament. And there was far-sighted leadership, including Senator Landrieu, and elected officials in the state and the community of New Orleans who were saying, how do we actually leverage this as an opportunity to do, to really rebuild the New Orleans education system? And I was amazed at that point, because usually people think in the short term, and of all times, at that point, you wouldn't expect people to think in the long term. But policies were put in place, including at the state level, on a bipartisan basis, that really made possible a lot of New Orleans reforms. And there was an expectation then this would be for the long term. The accountability system, the recovery school district, the charter, school laws, the human capital. So there's a real triumph of policymaking, I think, that's often understated in terms of what actually has happened in New Orleans first. Second, as key as I had, and I would say, is I was struck when my wife and my son moved down there, and my 4-year-old daughter was born in New Orleans about a year after that. The level of, there was an all hands on deck environment in New Orleans at that point. Community leaders, leaders from all backgrounds, were saying, you know what? This is no time for getting around, there's no time for politics. We've got to roll up our sleeves and make progress for kids in New Orleans. And I've never seen kind of that civic engagement from all quarters. It was messy that actually made it possible a lot of nonprofit and policy success. And I think the second untold story of New Orleans is the power of community leadership, parents, community members, local organization leaders of all kinds who were just committed to doing whatever it takes to make success possible. And then third is I think that organizations like New Schools New Orleans then stepped in, but I think had it not been for the policymaking and the community and civic leadership, even the brilliant design and execution of New Schools for New Orleans wouldn't have made a difference. But there was policy to execute, there was leadership at the grassroots level that was looking to make a difference. And I think that without kind of New Schools New Orleans, and there are very few organizations like this, organizations around the country, to come in and help kind of corral and channel and connect and network and both, essentially leverage both local talent as well as national talent to come in, I think both the policy that had been established and the community leadership that had been exercised wouldn't have come together in a way that would have been able to create a system like that. So the New School of New Orleans played a crucial role.
And John, I'd just like to follow up on that, and you've captured it beautifully, but I would like to make clear that actually prior to Katrina, everything that's been said is true about Katrina after the shock and the tears and the crying, and we looked up to see how we had to rebuild our community, and this is Gulf Coast wide, but particularly in the New Orleans region, that sustained 12 to 14 feet of water that stayed for 6 weeks and rendered most places uninhabitable, including 100 of our 146 schools in Orleans Parish. Hospitals, libraries, 250,000 homes uninhabitable. But prior to Katrina happening, our state had been on about a 15-year tough but steady slog through the legislature, primarily led by our Board of Elementary and Secondary Education, which is a elected and appointed Board of Elementary and Secondary Education, had really been working very closely with the Clinton administration, the Bush administration, and then the Obama administration. Of course, Obama was after Katrina, so it was really with primarily with the Clinton administration and the Bush administration on what little education reform was coming out of Washington and pushing. We were absorbing that before Katrina. So we had created, and I think if my staff correct me if I'm wrong, the recovery district was created prior to Katrina because our state had been one of the states, and maybe you all know of other states, but our state had been one of the few states that had recognized that we had to identify failing schools and do something with them. Traditional schools. What do you do with a failing school? Now the federal government is mandating that all states have to come up with a plan. But before the federal government mandated it, Louisiana had mandated itself. And what we had come up with is a statewide recovery school district. Some of you, I think Tennessee calls yours the achievement district. But that is a fundamental policy that now must be done because you're under a federal mandate to do it. We had done that prior to Katrina. We had also ceded a couple of charter schools. I did a $3 million earmark when I could do earmarks to create two charter schools. Tried to give the money to the New Orleans School Board, $3 million, give it to them. The only string attached was take this money and create two charter schools. They wouldn't do it. So I took the money back and I gave it to the University of New Orleans. And I said, okay, my school board won't create these two charter schools. Here's $3 million. You create two charter schools, which they did, which was the second and third charter to be in New Orleans. The first was created by one of our BESSE board members, Leslie Jacobs, I guess with the permission of the New Orleans School Board at the time, and Tony Rakosna, who's very famous and well-known African-American leader, stepped up to run the first charter school. So I don't want you all to think that it was just, you know, we had made the seeds of reform, and our state, both Republican and Democratic governors, for the last 15 years, have been favorably inclined towards this education transformation, and our legislature, and the senators, mostly me, and a few other in our congressional delegation, but mostly through my office, have been pushing and pushing these policies for a long time. And then when Katrina happened, it was sort of the spark, I hate to say it, because it really wasn't a spark, it was really a drench, kind of allowed us to push out these reforms that we felt like would work. And then we had the unbelievable opportunity to have many nonprofits come in. And then the other key was when FEMA started to reimburse the city of New Orleans for the 100 schools that were destroyed, and they wanted to, under the current FEMA law, to reimburse each school based on how many pencils were lost, how many blackboards were ruined, how many desks were ruined, and wanted to give me 1,000 small checks to go find an old-fashioned desk, because that's the law. FEMA said, the federal law actually does not allow you to do anything better than was there before, which is a ridiculous law, and I refuse to accept it and had the foresight and the wisdom to say, no, keep your money, I don't want it, and worked for 3 years to get that FEMA law changed. What then they were able to do is write a check for $1.8 billion to the Recovery School District, which is unbelievable if you think about it in this time. And we took that money and developed a master plan for the physical development of this transformation. Now, nowhere else in the nation will this be possible to this scale on the physical side, you know, the buildings, unless we have an infrastructure bank, which we're working on, or unless we come up with some innovative ways, which I'm working on right now with the secretary and have some ideas about how to use the current budget money to do that. But that also helped. But I have to say, even without that physical insertion of $1.8 billion, which has really helped, because now you have kids walking into LEED-certified, extraordinary buildings and charter school operators, I think we would have still been able to achieve what New Schools has shared with you. But the added blessing and bonus has been that we were able to do it with some construction dollars too, which is not really available right now to many of your districts. But just put that in perspective, I still think we could have achieved the outcomes, but now we're achieving them in really actually very beautiful facilities. And in fact, in the next 3 or 4 years, we will have almost every school physically renovated or built new in the whole city. It's pretty amazing.
I think there is often this question of, is New Orleans really replicable, given that the conditions in New Orleans after the storm were so unique? And Senator, I think you've done a wonderful job of discussing how that didn't actually, the storm might have been catalytic, but there was actually a lot of groundwork that had been laid previously. I think it's at this time actually worth recognizing Margot Rowan is here up in the front row, and Margot's from Tennessee, and I think part of the reason it's worth acknowledging her is they are actually part of the same grant. And the Tennessee's Achievement School District, led by the state superintendent there, Kevin Huffman, and Chris Barbeck, who oversees that school district, are actually working on trying to take the lessons learned here from New Orleans and apply those directly to Tennessee, and particularly looking at Nashville and in Memphis. So there are some lessons to be learned, and we're appreciative of that. I think both the senators who are hosting this are co-chairs of the Senate Public Charter School Caucus. And we generally talk about how charter schools are something, generally charter schools are something that happen alongside the rest of the system, right? New Orleans, it's completely flipped. So in the country, charter schools teach about 2% of all of our students. In New Orleans, it's around 80%. And we'd love to hear from you, Nirav, in terms of kind of how that looks like, what that looks like on the ground, sort of what's different about that. You talked a bit about how the role of government really shifts, and instead of the district actually running schools, they're doing a whole bunch of other things, such as ensuring equity, which is obviously incredibly important. But we'd love to also hear a little bit more about what the kind of political dynamics are on the ground, and what are the other, what's the other kinds of support that you all need to make sure that this work continues to be successful.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of points we want to make here. First, one of the untold kind of stories, and I think it hits a little bit on Senator Landrieu's point about what was happening before the storm, is the first wave of charter schools in New Orleans were actually led by veteran New Orleans educators. So while the system itself wasn't working before the storm, there were some unbelievably talented people. So I don't want the takeaway of this to be, oh, Teach for America came in and, you know, some young people from out of town opened schools. The first wave of charter schools was veteran African-American school leaders who'd been in New Orleans. And everybody in New Orleans knew who the best educators were, and when they were able to get a power, be empowered, and start their own charter schools, they all gravitated towards each other. So I think the New Orleans story politically is a little more complicated on the ground than kind of reformer versus traditionalist. What's really happened is it's been a fundamental overhaul where everybody in the system transitioned to a new system. And I think that making that next jump of charter schools as a vehicle to do 2%, 3%, 4% versus charter schools as a way to restructure a school district is perhaps the greatest thing that we can take from New Orleans. And politically, having a very diverse array of leaders and teachers in these schools has been very important. And then on the highest, you know, grass tops level, the bipartisan nature of this has truly been phenomenal. I mean, we have gone through two mayors, a Democratic governor started it, a Republican governor now continues it. Both senators from the Democratic and Republican Party are supportive. It's just been incredible to watch parties with very different orientations coalescing around the idea of empowering great educators. I think that lesson is transferable as well. If you can get an incredible diverse group of politicians to agree on this type of reform, there's no reason we can't start scaling this to other cities across the country.
Hi, my name is Ashana Vigart, and I'm a parent of a child who's in the charter school in New Orleans. There was one point that you said that I really agree on, and that's everybody in New Orleans wants what's best for our children. Most of the rest of what you said, I disagree. And as an advocate, a lot of what you said was striking a lot of chords with me because I've been doing advocacy and working on the school prison pipeline since 2006. And because there's no accountability for the new charter schools, a lot of you do not know the federal and state laws. So, I mean, I'm pretty sure you've even seen some of the news broadcasts that we're talking about. Some of the charter schools not allowing parents into the board meetings. And it's been a real pushback in New Orleans, not to say what kind of school it should be, but that it should be community inclusion. And when you talk about great leadership, when they fired the first 6,000 teachers who were qualified teachers. Nothing against Teach for America. I think it would be a wonderful program if it was a teaching assistant program. But I ask you honestly, how many of you, if you had a mechanic who had had 5 weeks of training, would then let him work on your car engine? You're working on my child's development. And as a parent of a child in one of these schools, who's had to talk to administrators about the law. I would beg you, before you push this model to another state, to please look at the data, go to the schools, go to the best performing school in our city, some of the best performing, which by the way were the best performing magnet schools before they chartered, which would be Lusher, Audubon Montessori, and they also cherry pick their students. If the child drops down to a C, they're asked to leave. They're not invited back to the school. But I'm saying this to say, because our children's lives are at stake, to study, to look at some of the schools that have our children walking in lines with their hands behind their backs, like they're in prison. And these are new charter schools that you're talking about who are saying they're doing great things. But then go look at Audubon Montessori and see the difference in how those children are acting. Some of these schools are saying they're great schools because when you walk in, you can hear a pin drop. If you know adolescent and early childhood development, you're not supposed to walk into a kindergarten class and hear a pin drop. But these people don't know. And so I beg you to go back, do the research, walk through the schools. If you want, I'll take you on a personal tour to show you.
First of all, let me say this. I've been through many of our charter schools, and I respectfully disagree with your assessment, but I would ask you this. What school is your child in, and you must have had a bad experience with your child? What school is your child in?
My child is in Morris Jeff Community School.
Morris Jeff. And did you like that school or no?
First of all, I didn't really have a choice.
Okay, hang on just a minute. You had Morris Jeff.
First of all, I really didn't have a choice.
And you didn't have a choice.
I applied to several schools. That was the school that would let my child in, first of all.
And is your child a special needs child?
No, my child is not special
needs. And what grade?
She's kindergarten.
Okay, so she's in kindergarten right now at Morris Jeff.
Yes.
Okay, and I'd love to visit with you afterwards, and maybe Deb has some suggestions as well. You know, we're not saying that the charter schools are perfect, and there's some weaknesses, and I'd love to describe some of those. But if you're not personally happy with where your child is, I can really help you to get into the school that you think would be best for your child. And what is your child?
It's from the B Corp.
Okay. Where is your child?
He's at Sophie, right? And my son transitioned from a parochial school to a public school. Mm-hmm. And I was utterly, almost depressed and in tears because I had to send my child to a D or an F school. in my city. The school that I wanted my child to go to was my alma mater, which is a C school, which I still think is not quality. Warren Easton High School. But he couldn't get into Warren Easton because everybody wants their child to go to Warren Easton.
So he had to go to quality school.
Exactly.
So he had to go to Sophie Wright?
He had to go to Sophie Wright. And I was happy to have her to take my child. But my district school is Saratoga Reed, a failing school. So I could have easily sent him there. Or any other school in the East. They're failing, and not only are they failing, but they're in trailers. I want what's best for my son.
And to send him to,
I understand that, ma'am. But it to no end to keep pushing and saying that we have choice. By definition, I have a choice. You are absolutely right. But when my choice is between sending my child to a D and an F school, I don't have very much of a choice.
Well, soon you're going to have a choice if our governor gets his way. You're going to have a voucher. You can send your child to any school anywhere you want. Now, I'm not a big fan of that. But, you know, in the old days, in the old school system, you had no choice whatsoever. You have some choices now, and I would love to work with you individually and get your child in any school that you want. I will work very hard to do that because that's one of the most important provisions of New Orleans being an open school system. Now, let me just describe, even though you've heard these two mothers say that they're not happy with their choices, and you've heard their senator commit to them that I will help you get your child in any school that you want. Let me tell you what the situation in America is right now. Most families, poor families in America, white, black, and Hispanic, live in a certain neighborhood. It's not the richest neighborhood in town, right? It doesn't have the best schools. They have usually poor schools, usually poor facilities. And almost every law in America today says the only school that those children can go to is the school in that district. Now, I've looked nationally at, and this gets back to the equity question, you can look and you can get this data off the computer today. In some districts in America, let's say in the top Houston districts, because it's a rich district and property taxes support the school, and the only way you live in that district is if you can afford a $500, $600, or $1 million home. That's the neighborhood. If you don't have a $1 million house, your kids don't go to that school. Those districts spend $20,000 to $25,000 a year to educate. In poor districts, and in New Orleans East, it's a poor area, but not completely. There's some very strong middle-class families in New Orleans East. And that would be a good example, but the poorest district in my state is Avoyelles Parish, and they're spending $7,000. So in America today, you have a range of counties, and maybe, Jim, you have more data on this, but it's available on the computer. The current system in America is you're trapped in the district in which you live. You most certainly cannot get out. And the discrepancy is very substantial. That's why the Black Caucus here in Washington is supportive of what I'm talking about, because they are tired representing millions of minority families that are stuck in these districts. Charters or charter movements give you an opportunity. Now, it doesn't have to be charters. You could do what some of us are advocating and saying, erase the boundaries so that parents can go wherever. You can get your child in the wealthy districts, you should be accepted. Now there's going to be a big political pushback, of course, to families that live in these districts, and they say, we pay high property taxes, we want our kids to go here. But the inequity in America right now is very disturbing. In my own state, I looked at my districts, I challenge you to go back and look at your districts. I have two counties, two parishes, where we're spending $21,000 per child. And in my poorest areas, we're only spending $7,900. Can you imagine the difference when you're spending $21,000 per child, what the outcome could be? Here in the District of Columbia, we're spending about $18,000 per child and still getting poor results. So there are many morals to this story. One, the current system traps more parents than our system. The current system traps parents all over this country and have virtually no choice. At least in New Orleans, parents can, now whether you can actually physically get there or physically get in because they're waiting list. And we're trying to say to the schools that have waiting lists, like Lusher and Warren Easton. We're trying to get Warren Easton 2 or Lusher 2 so that kids, you know, we don't have to have that much of a waiting list. But let's get other people, and I'll be happy to talk with y'all afterwards. Let's say one more thing.
But it's not a waiting list issue. I can, you know what, ma'am?
I appreciate you saying that
you want to help us, you know, get, but I can call all of my cousins who have multiple children who are all transferred to different bus stops every morning to go to different schools because they don't have a choice. My little cousin is having an issue right now at 17 Reed. And her mom's like, I don't know what to do. I could try and make my connections to try and get her into a school, but that doesn't work. There isn't real choice.
Well, not in New Orleans East.
I think it's not enough yet, but
there was no choice before. There's much more choice than there was in the old system. No one had choice in the old system. You had to go to the school in your district, period.
I didn't go to the school.
That is true.
We were educated in New Orleans, ma'am.
That is true, except for magnet schools. Except for magnet schools.
So I hear that there's significant disagreement on this issue, and I don't think anybody up here trying to say the system is perfect. I do think that this is a conversation that is probably better had one-on-one or two-on-one. And so encourage us to proceed there. We are actually over time, and I'm getting the kill signal from various folks.
Good deal.
So thank you all for coming.
Can we close out with just a couple of quick points?
Yep, please.
Okay. So what I started off at the beginning saying is one of the reasons that we need a program like I-3 is we've had a series of persistent challenges in education that trap our children in underperforming circumstances for years. It is not going to change overnight. What we are seeing is, and this conversation was illustrative of it, that until we actually produce enough supply of quality schools, choices are limited for everyone. There are too few schools for the number of kids who need them. That is the fundamental issue. We've seen through the data that what we produced is significantly better than what was there before. But where we sit today, 40% of the schools still are below the line. That's why children can't find what they're looking for. We've also heard that even the schools that are above the line aren't doing everything the way that exactly that they make sure they should be. Need to look at what the case is. The point of fact is that this is going to be a journey. It's not going to be pretty. It is going to take fits and starts to get there. What we are seeing is the kind of innovation, the kind of opportunity, the kind of change that if we actually keep this tension strong, we can ultimately come out the other end, not overnight, but in a few years, that will actually create the kind of supply of educational opportunities that will give all of our children a chance. That's where we are. It's not pretty, but if we stick with it, we'll get it.
Thank you very much.